Let's say a little prayer, everybody. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Mighty Father, we give you thanks and praise for your great glory, for the love that you've shown us in your Son, who was born into the world like one of us in all things but sin. We pray that by the merits of your Son's passion and death on the cross, that you might send the Holy Spirit upon us, that you might enliven our hearts, make them soft and attentive to the word that you want to speak to us today, so that we might know the riches you offer us in sacred scripture. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right, well, as Jonathan said, I'm Father Kevin Dyer. I'm a Jesuit priest. I've been a Jesuit for 16 years, a priest for 5 years. I teach at Jesuit High School in New Orleans. I teach sophomore boys, the lowest form of life on the planet. Christ in his least recognizable form. The second lowest form of life is a freshman girl. Then dolphins, and then tenors. So there, that's the scale of being right there. And it's my first year in New Orleans. Before that, was in Denver, Colorado, at Regis High School. So great to be with you all here. We have at least one graduate of Regis Jesuit High School here today. Do we have any Jesuit High School New Orleans people? Okay, that will change. We're talking about Lectio Divina today, so let's get started with just a little story of St. Ignatius Loyola, who began his life, Catholic family. He was, willing to check all the boxes. But at the end of the day, he was looking out for himself. He wanted glory in the worldly sense. He wanted to be a soldier, a courtier. He wanted to be well thought of by people in society. And he had this traumatic experience while fighting in a battle in Pamplona, in Spain, in which he was hit by a cannonball. The bones in his legs were broken. And the soldiers on the opposing French side thought that he was so valiant in battle that they themselves carried him back to his home of Loyola, to his castle. And there he began to recuperate. And while he was on his recovery bed, he said, "Bring me something to read. What I'd like is a romance novel," which in those days was not like Fabio with long hair. It was more along the lines of an action movie. That's what he wanted. "Bring me an action movie." So we don't have any of those around here. We got two books for you. We got The Lives of the Saints. We have The Life of Christ. He said, "Okay, it's better than nothing." So he picks up the book, and here's a passage that he read on the very first page of that Life of Christ, written by a Carthusian monk named Ludolf of Saxony. "The sinner who already faithfully believes in Christ should strive to stay close to this physician by devoutly meditating on his most holy life as much as possible. But take care to do this with deliberation and not hurry through the reading of Christ's life. Rather, take a small section in turn each day. With such devout reflections, you can celebrate a daily Sabbath for Christ. Your thoughts, feelings, prayers, praises, and all of your daily work will lead to this, and you will find delight in it." And so while he's recovering from this injury, he celebrated a daily Sabbath where he just picked up this Life of Christ and very slowly went through the different stories. as he reads through these stories, something begins to happen inside of him. He becomes inspired by what he's reading there. He begins to think, maybe I could be like this. Maybe a different way of living is possible for me. And there's a bunch of back and forth and, you know, a whole story to go into. But for right now, all we need to say is that while he was recuperating, he was introduced to the church's tradition of Lectio Divina, of prayer with Scripture. And that prayer with Scripture changed his life. It was simple. It was solid. It was life-changing. It can be the same for you. It can be the same for the people in your Bible studies that you work with. So let's dig in. Okay, in this first part, we're going to just cast the vision for what Lectio Divina is, just the basic outlines of this type of prayer. Benedict XVI had some great things to say. A bunch of the popes had great things to say about Lectio Divina. But you know, notice some of these important words. A prayer which brings about an intimate dialogue. This is a key word, dialogue. In which the person reading hears God who's speaking, and in praying, responds with openness of heart. Lectio Divina is a way of just picking up the Bible and in those words of Scripture, hearing God speaking to you, and then carrying on the dialogue by speaking back. Now, why? So Lectio Divina is basically, you know, Lectio reading, Divina, divine, holy, holy reading. Okay, why is it not just reading, though? You know, first, you're not just reading Scripture as you would any other book. It's a reading which is prayerful. It's a reading which acknowledges that there's someone else around, not just you. That God is present, inviting you to have this dialogue. It's personal. There is someone who responds to you. The deeper you go, the more you're aware of this personal reality, who is God, responding to you in your daily prayer. Now, I found a really interesting testimony from a Carthusian monk. So the Carthusians, just a quick bit, the Carthusians are just awesome. You should love the Carthusians. They say they're the only order that's never been reformed because they never needed it. They were formed by St. Bruno, and they live a life almost completely hidden from the world, a life devoted to prayer and penance on behalf of the world. And some great saints have been Carthusians. In fact, we don't even know all the saints in the Carthusian order because they didn't want to be known. A lot of times when they put out a book, they'll often just sign it, a Carthusian monk. My name's not important. What's important is what I'm talking about. And so I came across this testimony from a Carthusian monk on Lectio Divina, and I think it'll be helpful. This has been reproduced in your program. Okay, this method of prayer, traditionally used in monasteries, was synthesized by Guigo II, the Carthusian. We'll talk more about Guigo in a bit. And it consists in reading slowly a passage of Holy Scripture, meditating on it leisurely. So it's like no stress. No stress. No pressure. Just pick it up. Slowly, leisurely, read it, take it in. Then you silently take the sentiments and feelings of gratitude, praise, repentance that this passage generates within you. Convert them into a prayer to the Lord. So if we just calm down, open up the Bible, and without pressure, begin to read it slowly and leisurely, inevitably, things are going to rise up within us. And as they do, you just turn them into prayer. It might be a question, okay, ask it to the Lord. It might be just a sense of gratitude. Lord, thank you for this. Okay, turn it into a prayer. It might be a fear. Turn it into a prayer. And then as you go forward, whatever is expressed in Scripture is going to sink down deeply into you and begin to transform your heart. Just think of it as this tremendous converter where the words of sacred Scripture come into you, allow something to raise up within you and convert that into a personal relationship with the Lord. Now, this mentions Guigo II. I'm hoping that this takes off as a focus baby name. It hasn't so far. We get, you know, lots of John Pauls. We haven't gotten many Guigos yet. But if we just keep on working on it, maybe one day you will be the first focus couple to name their child Guigo. He wrote a book called Scale of the Cloister, The Ladder of the Cloister, in which he put forward kind of the first organized system of what happens in Lectio Divina, but really what happens in Christian prayer. Okay, this isn't a technique for praying. I think it's more that he's just saying, hey, here's what happens when Christians pray. And it's just helpful for us to hear this and to understand a little bit. Okay, so he says that there's four basic moments or periods in prayer. Okay, there's reading, there's meditation, there's prayer, and there's contemplation. Now let's talk about each of these in turn so that we can, you know, learn a little bit about the nature of Christian prayer. First, reading. Christian prayer begins with a something. It begins with Scripture. Why? Because where you begin matters greatly. Think about it. Let's say that you have an afternoon to waste. You have an afternoon to waste, and you're a music fan. You're like, okay, over here, I have this collection of Haydn right here. I could spend my afternoon listening to that. Okay. Over here, I have my collection of death metal. So, let's see, which one am I going to choose? Now, at the end of the day, if you spent the afternoon listening to Haydn, do you think your internal state would be different than if you spent your afternoon listening to death metal? It would seem that the input does have some impact upon the state of your soul. Well, Christians say, yes, absolutely. That's why we begin with Scripture. This is how God has revealed his face to us, through the story of his people, and most particularly in the face of Jesus Christ. So prayer begins with a something. It doesn't begin with an emptiness. And that's why Lectio Divina begins with opening up the Bible. There's a something that's there that's waiting for me. And so I begin with that. Now, okay, what do I do then? I've opened it up. I've started, you know, looking at the passages. I've started reading. What do I do? The Catechism has some great stuff on what meditation is. That's what begins to happen after we read. Meditation. Now, we're used to the idea of meditation, and that you like clear your mind of everything, you know, and you know you just stare out into the great emptiness, the great stillness, with nothing there. That's not Christian meditation. In fact, Christian meditation is the exact opposite. Christian meditation, what happens is, no, there's a something there, and I begin to work over it inside of myself. I begin to apply myself to it. I begin to apply my thoughts, my imagination, my emotions, my desires. I mobilize everything that's within me and apply it to what's expressed in sacred Scripture. Meditation is something active within Christian prayer and within Lectio Divina. It's something active. When I open up the Scripture, I'm going to read, and then I'm going to just put my insides to work. I'm going to put my insides to work in allowing this to impact me? And inevitably, as the Carthusian said, inevitably, it's going to lead to prayer. Oh, one more thing. Why did I put that picture there of the heart, of the Sacred Heart? This is why. We talk about praying with the heart. The heart is the center of who you are. Meditation is moving toward prayer of the heart. It's the center of who you are, the unified part of who you are, where your thoughts and your feelings and your will and your imagination and everything gets unified together. And you as a unified person say, Lord, I have come to know you and to turn my heart over to you. Meditation leads us to prayer of the heart, where everything is firing together. All right, prayer. As we said, this is that moment where you take what is going on within you, what you read in the scripture, and you begin to lift your eyes up, say, God, I know you're there. I'm going to say something to you. And this is the part where you might think, I don't have anything really exciting or important or profound to say. Like other people, they know how to pray because they're always saying like really profound things. That's a huge trap in prayer. If all you say to the Lord is, Lord, I love you. Lord, I trust you. Lord, I want to follow you. And you mean it? That's a great prayer. Notice the difference between the first two stages. You know, with reading and meditation, even a non-believer can really do that, right? If someone doesn't believe in God, they can pick up a Bible. They can read it. They can think about it, right? Only a believer can do this. This is the moment where, you know, the flag is set and put down, where we say, Lord, I believe that you are real because I'm talking to you right now. I'm talking to you right now. And so we see this this picture over here of Martha and Mary and Lazarus because it's such a good depiction from sacred scripture of a dialogue. Lazarus, good person. Martha, good person. Mary is the one who just sits at his feet, recognizes Jesus as a person, listens to him, talks to him, and Jesus says, Mary, you've chosen the better part. This is an image of what prayer is in Lectio Divina, where we recognize God, say, I want to listen to you, I want to talk to you, I just want to be with you. And eventually what happens, not every time we pray, not every time we pray, but sometimes, all the effort seems to drop away. And we no longer have to work so hard. We just become cognizant of the fact that the Lord is here. He is with me. And he begins to do all the work. This is one of the understandings of what contemplation is. That on the Lord's time, everything just seems to fade away. Everything, all the work, and he stretches, just fades away, and I know that he's there. And I'm receiving from him whatever it is that he wants to give to me. And I know that it is absolutely, completely his gift. So these are the stages that Guigo talks about. That doesn't happen, you know, in every prayer. Again, this is not like a lockstep formula. It's just like, he's looking at people praying over the course of years and saying, this is the stuff. This is the best way of explaining what happens in prayer. Reading, meditation, prayer, and contemplation. We good? Making sense? Okay. Let's just talk then about some building blocks of spiritual life and of prayer that will be in the background as you teach your own Bible studies how to pray. All right? First, silence. you guys have experienced this, I'm sure, right? We've all experienced this. That first time that we just sit down to pray and, holy cow, I've turned off every machine around me. I'm not saying anything. It's just me and the Lord, and it can be intimidating. And you see this, right, in your Bible studies. Like, the first time you try to be silent, it can be a little awkward. And, yeah, depending on the maturity of your group, any number of different noises or sounds could take place. Laughter, like nervous laughter, you know, things like that. Okay, silence is essential for prayer. And when we have that first nervous energy about being silent, we just need to make our way through it. And the key word here is trust. To like trust that if I am alone with the Lord, He's not going to let me down. So all of us need to find time of silence where distractions are put to the side, where we don't worry about anything else, and we can just be alone with the Lord. Commitment. It's good to keep in mind, just because I sit down to pray one time, I shouldn't expect, okay, my world's going to be rocked by praying this one time. Prayer is really more like a habit. And if we develop that habit over time, the Lord's going to do something. Remember, Ignatius didn't have just one moment of conversion. He was laying on that recovery bed for months. But each day of those months, he took his mini Sabbath, and he was there with the Lord. And by that commitment to prayer, he gave the Lord an opening by which he could speak to his heart and change his life. And then finally, prayer with the heart. Prayer in the Christian context is full contact. Okay, it's full contact prayer. That's why at Mass, you know, we'll kneel. We'll stand. We'll sit. It's why in prayer, you know, sometimes people will stand up and raise their hands to the heavens. Some people just like to sit down. But it engages the body. It engages the imagination, where you're imagining the stories and the people and everything that happens in Scripture. It engages your emotions, where you're bringing your emotions to the Lord and allowing Him to speak to you at that level. It engages your intellect and your understanding. And it engages your will. The whole person together. There's a great line in the Screwtape Letters. Who here has ever read the Screwtape Letters before? Okay. You know, a big C.S. Lewis book. It's a demon advising younger demons on how to tempt people to the bad side. And he says, okay, if you fail and they start praying, don't worry. Things aren't lost. Encourage them to just keep their prayer at the level of the emotions as like a nice sentiment of, ah. If you do that, yeah, the day is won. Whatever you do, don't let their prayer impact their intellect or their will. As soon as it impacts their intellect or their will, okay, the day is lost. And that's just such a good illustration of how prayer can go wrong. Christian prayer is prayer with everything you are. Your emotions, your intellect, your will, the whole person, just right there engaged with the Lord. Just think about it. You know, when you, anybody who played sports here, who had to practice really hard, you know, learning an instrument or something, if you just went in, you know, with half your energy, you were not going to get good. You were going to get good much better if every time you sat down to practice, you were completely engaged with your whole person. Prayer is the same way. Every time I sit down, I'm engaged with my whole person. All right, so this is the vision of Lectio Divina. And, you know, we said a lot, you know, we'll only remember, 10% of what was said, right? Now we're going to get into more like some techniques that you can use for when you're praying, all right? So this is the main part, the main course, so to speak, of the talk. I'll just take a moment very quickly to see if there's any questions that people had. All right. The method that we are going to talk about today and that you're going to use in your small groups is basically a three-reading method of Lectio Divina. And we're taking some advice from Fulton Sheen, an analogy that Fulton Sheen gave for prayer. And so he thought prayer with scripture was like a culinary analogy, of taste, of chew, of swallow. That taste is when, you just very briefly survey the scripture, see what sticks out to you. But then, after a time, you chew over it. You bounce it around in your head. You try to break it apart. You try to draw the meaning. You try to, draw the marrow out of the word. So that eventually, you can allow that to sink into your heart and change who you are. Taste, chew, swallow. Taste, chew, swallow. I like the lightning bolts on the NBC microphone over there. I don't know why, but. Now, notice, we've already talked about this. Let's just make it explicit. When we were talking about prayer of the heart and who we are, we can break this down, traditionally, we can break this down into three things. When we're going to prayer, we have an imagination where we can, imagine the story. We can picture in our minds what's happening. We have an intellect where we begin to understand in a deeper way what Scripture means. And then we have a will whereby we desire and choose a course of action. And notice how this method is just integrating this. Taste is like the imagination. What immediately inflames your imagination or sticks out to you? Okay, read Scripture again and see what sticks out to your intellect. Chew over it. What meaning are you drawing out from this? And then the will, swallow, allow it to sink into you and change how you live and how you make decisions. So when we're talking about a three-reading method of Lectio Divina, we're talking about you're sitting down. How many of you lead a Bible study? All right. You're sitting down with your Bible study. You're saying, hey, we're gonna learn how to pray today. We're going to pray with Scripture today. And you're very simply just picking up the Bible, like, all right, this is going to be the story. You quiet everybody down, get through the nervous laughter, read it one time, allow it to, see how their imagination latches on to a word or an image or something like that. Read it again. Give them some time to chew over it, to think about it, see, why is this interesting? What does this have to say to me in my life? Where is God trying to communicate? And then read it again and just allow it to sink in. And what am I going to do as a result of this? Very simple. Just in preparation for this, was calling up some missionaries and just asking for advice. Like, what's working in your Bible study? And some of the missionaries do something like this and said this was really effective in leading a Bible study. Particularly, if you're with people who are new to prayer and kind of nervous about it, doing it like this is awesome. A second method, we're not going to go much into this, but I'll just let you know about it. There's another method that people use called RAP. It's an acronym. Where the W stands for right. And so, if a person's trying to pick up personal prayer, like they're going to go on their own and they want to, get into prayer, but, their mind gets distracted and they're bouncing all over the place, they will, what can be helpful is, okay, first, when you're praying, write down the passages or the images that stick out to you. Once you've done that, reflect on what it's saying and how it's impacting you. Apply it to your life, and then pray whatever's on your heart. In your program, there's a little template that you can find, somewhere in there. There's a little template for rap prayer. The reason that we're not going to talk about it very much is that your campus missionaries have already been trained in this. And so if you yourself are wanting some advice in your own personal prayer, or you have someone in your Bible study who's wanting to go further in their personal prayer, talk to your campus ministries, and they can give you some advice on rap or other methods of prayer. Okay? So that's your resource there. We're going to stick at the level of the three reading method for today. You know, and so like I said, the three reading method is good for a Bible study with people who are new to prayer. Okay? So it's perfect for the people that you are working with. It's a great way to lead them into prayer. Also, if you have a group that, you know, they just have a tough time sharing what's going on, a lot of people that are just kind of being silent and not saying much in your Bible study, this can be a way of drawing people out to share with other people in a way that's not too threatening to them. The rap method is pretty good maybe when people start saying, I want to go to holy hour with you, and I want to pray with Scripture, but I don't know how to do it. That's a good time maybe to bring rap method out. We're just going to pray right now. All right? We're going to pray right now. In order to do this, first, let's get some people. I want you in groups of three. Just get into a group of three or four people. So just take 30 seconds and find your folks. If you need to rearrange your chairs a little bit, do that. But yeah, get into some small groups here. Just get comfortable. You don't need to see the screen. That's not important. I'll read the passages to you, so you're not going to have any need for the screen. Take a moment, close your eyes. Let's just be silent for a bit. And possibly, maybe if someone could shut the door to the room in the back, that'd be helpful. Okay, we're going to take 2 minutes of silence. Just if distractions start to come up, anxieties, anything like that that comes to your heart, just allow those to pass by. Just like debris in a river. Allow it to float on down past you, down the river. So 2 minutes of silence. Lord, we know that you are here in our midst, that you are looking down upon us, and that you're pleased that we're here. And we know that your Holy Spirit is powerful and praying in our heart. So we ask you to lead us deeper into prayer. Lead us deeper into the Word, which you're speaking to us today. I'm going to read the passage slowly. And I encourage you just to be attentive as I read it. Very simply, if there are any words, phrases, images, or people that stick out to you. And then after I read it, we'll take another 2 minutes for you to just see what it is that sticks to your heart. Simeon came in the Spirit into the temple. And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to perform the custom of the law in regard to him, he took him into his arms and blessed God, saying, Lord, now let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal you to the nations and the glory of your people, Israel. The child's father and mother were amazed at what was said about him. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary his mother, Behold, this child is destined for the fall and rise of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be contradicted, and you yourself a sword will pierce, so that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. Just take 2 minutes to think back. What was it that stuck out to you? For me, as I prayed with this, it was the image of Simeon taking the child Jesus in his arms and just kind of the look on his face as he took the child Jesus into his arms. In your small group, very briefly, just say, what was the image or phrase that stuck out to you? Again, you don't need to explain why it stuck out. Just very briefly, what stuck out? All right, so I'm going to read this again, and this time, okay, we had taste, chew over it. As I read it again, that stuff that sticks out to you, think about it. What does it mean? What's the Lord trying to say to you? Okay? And now this time, be attentive. As something moves within you, turn it into a prayer. Like, address God specifically about what's going on in your heart. And even take a little time to be silent to see, you know, is God saying something back to you? Maybe he will, maybe he won't. But just, you know, this the second time we read it, allow it to bounce around within you. And as things rise up in your heart, turn them into a prayer to the Lord. Simeon came in the Spirit into the temple. And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to perform the custom of the law in regard to him, he took him into his arms and blessed God, saying, Lord, now let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen the salvation which you prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal you to the nations and the glory of your people Israel. The child's father and mother were amazed at what was said about him, and Simeon blessed them and said to Mary his mother, behold, this child is destined for the fall and rise of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be contradicted, and you yourself a sword will pierce, so that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. We'll take about 5 to 7 minutes of silence right now, just to chew over this passage. So I stayed with that image of Simeon. And just the joy in his eyes, seeing the Lord's plan, you know, brought to fruition. And just in my own heart, I could kind of share in the excitement, but there was also a little bit of just resistance in my heart. You know, because I was kind of doubting God's plan and how it was working out in my own life. You know, and so, you know, the prayer that I turned that into was, all right, Lord, do I trust you? Lord, I want to trust you. I want my heart to be with you. I see that it all comes around. I see that it all comes around. Help me to trust in your plan the way that Simeon did so that I can rejoice the way he did. In your own small group, what was it that occupied your own heart during this prayer? All right, let's bring it back in. This third time, we're focused upon the will, allowing the word to just sink more deeply into our heart, particularly asking the question, how does this impact how I will live, a decision I will make, my daily life? So again, I just encourage you to focus in on, you know, how it's appealing to your will. And again, as something moves your heart, turn it into a prayer. Address God directly as a person who wants to speak to you and communicate to you. Simeon came in the temple, in the Spirit, into the temple. And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to perform the custom of the law in regard to him, he took him into his arms and blessed God, saying, Lord, now let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal you to the nations and the glory of your people Israel. The child's father and mother were amazed at what was said about him. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, "Behold, this child is destined for the fall and rise of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be contradicted, and you yourself a sword will pierce, so that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed." We'll take 5 minutes of silence. Carrying on with, you know, with that prayer of, you know, kind of struggling with the Lord over his plan and, you know, and trusting him, I began to feel, you know, a little bit more, you know, reassurance. And but then, you know, those other words, you know, of the for the Blessed Mother, "You yourself a sword will pierce," kind of entered into my heart, that, you know, the Lord's plan always involves some sacrifice in this world. You know, always involves ups and downs. You know, just, you know, a sense of peace, knowing that the Lord's with me in the ups and downs. And so an ability to say back to him, "All right, Lord, according to your will, according to your will." And some peace in my heart that that came from that, and just recommitting myself to the Lord's plan in my life and going forward. So, yeah. Now for your groups, share a little bit. All right, let's just thank the Lord. Just thank the Lord for being present to us, for giving us this opportunity for prayer. As together we pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen." All right. So there we go. That's basically what you're going to be doing, you know, this afternoon in the power sessions. So let's just talk about that right now, just preparing for the power sessions. I see a few people like the blueberry and strawberry tart. Yeah, it's good stuff. It's good stuff. Raspberry chocolate tart is my favorite. Okay, here's maybe a way of structuring it. You know, basically four parts to the power session. That first, you would begin with a little personal testimony or story about the importance of praying with Scripture. Then you would explain what Lectio Divina is, you know, just simply, straightforwardly. Then you would actually pray. And then at the end, give them some encouragement for the future. All right, so let's talk about step one first. And it might be helpful if you all open up the programs to page 26. So you're going to see the handouts and the information that's going to be at your disposal there on page 26. All right, first, just the personal testimony. I gave you the story of St. Ignatius, you know, and there's kind of three elements to giving a testimony of the importance of praying with Scripture. First, how I was, then some kind of blessing you received as a result of praying with Scripture, and finally, how you're different. So, you know, for Ignatius, it was, you know, he was kind of a wild guy. He was living something of a shallow, superficial life. He was forced to just sit down with the life of Christ and pray. And as a result, he turned in an opposite direction and, you know, eventually became a saint. But he gave up what had been going on before. Now, for yourselves, you know, maybe you have your own story of a time you prayed with Scripture and it was something that impacted your heart, that you experienced God in a more personal way through praying with Scripture. If you don't have a story, well, use someone else's story. Work on your own story. It's a little encouragement for your own personal prayer to eventually, you know, find your own story of how Scripture made a difference to you. But again, this doesn't have to be long. It's just to introduce the prayer session. Okay, and then I don't think we have time. We won't practice the sharing. For the explaining of what Lectio Divina is, you don't have to do any of this. What I provided you in the program was the little testimony from the Carthusian monk that might structure some thoughts. I think, you know, what's important here is that you're just slowly bringing scripture in. You're allowing it to sink into your imagination, your intellect, and your will. And then you speak to God about what's happening so that it will change the way you live, so that it will impact your life. That's it. Again, you come up with your own explanation for what Lectio Divina is, what prayer with scripture is. This is just, you know, here to help you out. All right, so then after that, you know, maybe just give them the three reading method analogy. So basically what we're going to do is we're going to do a three reading method of Lectio Divina. I'm going to read it three times, and the first time is really, you know, allow it to be aimed at your intellect, or it's at your imagination. The second time is more, you know, for the intellect, the mind, what it means, and the third time for your will, what you're going to do about it. And maybe give them Fulton Sheen's analogy of taste, chew, swallow, okay, so that the word just sinks into who you are, becomes part of you. Now, for the leading Lectio, just do exactly what I did, all right? You just start out with silence, you know, and then the three readings for taste, chew, swallow, imagination, intellect, will. Notice, in the program here, I just made some notes, you know, kind of a little script that you can use to just remind yourself of what to say, of how to go about it. But a few things to keep in mind. Explain. Notice how, as we were going through it, the first thing I did was explained in as simple of terms as I could what we are about to do. I am going to read scripture. I want you to see how it is going to appeal to your imagination. Simple. It could be a word. It could be a phrase. You know, it could be an image. But just allow it to speak to you at a surface level. Okay. Then notice, signaling. I said, all right, now we're going to have silence for 2 minutes. Because what happens if you just say, all right, now we're going to be silent? What's the first thing that starts to go on within you? Oh, how long am I going to be here? When is this going to stop? Okay, I don't have anything more. Am I going to have to go back and try to make something again? Yeah. Whereas if you know, okay, 2 minutes, you know what to expect. Okay, this time we're going to do a little bit longer. We're going to do 5 minutes. All right, I can work with that. So just setting expectations as you lead the group through is going to help them relax and know what they're doing. Next, modeling. That after the silence, each time, I started by sharing on my own. You know, and the first time, I wanted the sharing to be brief, and so I myself gave a brief sharing. Like, this was the image. Yeah, the first time. You just, you know, this was the image, or this was the phrase. What about you all? Everybody goes around. You know, the next time. Okay, this is how it appealed to my intellect. So you model you know, what it's supposed to look like, more or less. Don't think that you have to share this amazingly vibrant or profound experience that you had. In fact, sometimes that can be counterproductive because people think, I didn't pray like that. Yeah, if it's just simple and straightforward, you know, people can relate to it, and it gives them, you know, permission to pray themselves. And then finally, encouragement. Just, you know, saying to people, you know, maybe someone says, nothing really much stuck out to me. That's fine. Doesn't always. You know? Or, you know, sometimes you'll get this. I kind of saw the Christ child, and I just kind of imagined I was holding him in my arms, and it was just so peaceful, you know, just feeling like I had, you know, the child Jesus there in my arms. But I don't know if it was a good prayer or not. You know, just the encouragement. Oh, yeah, that's a great prayer. Yeah, it was awesome. Well, we're speaking to you in it. Of course, that's a great prayer. Or, you know, the encouragement of just saying, you know, the Lord is present. you are sitting here trying to pray. Don't you think he's pleased by that? Those are just important things to say to give people encouragement of heart that they can pray. Because let me tell you, a lot of people struggle with prayer for a long time. Some people, you know, they just take right to it. They just hit the ground running. Other people, it takes them a while, and that's okay. There's a lot of people who have, you know, been at, you know, they've been praying for a long time. You think, boy, that must be the all-star of prayer. And they will be the first to admit, oh, no, it took me a long time to learn how to pray. And that's fine. That's fine. Just, I think that encouragement is very important when you're leading a Bible study. You know, at the very end of it, again, very briefly, you can just point them and say, you know, in the book, you know, if you yourself want to really dive more deeply into your personal prayer, I have a 40-day kind of a Lenten challenge in there. And you can just, you know, show that to people. Say, all right, for Lent, are you wanting to develop your prayer life? Here's 40 passages arranged by certain themes that you could pray with for those 40 days. There's also the wrap template that's in there. But, you know, just encourage people that there's a lot of resources within Focus to encourage people in praying more. In fact, since the get-go, the thing that has impressed me the most about Focus is that they are based not in technique or flash or glitter or talent. From the get-go, they have always been based in prayer, and they do a lot of things to back that up. The daily holy hours that your missionaries do. Just the way that the leadership of the organization speaks and conducts its affairs. They always go back to the importance of prayer, that this is always grounded in prayer. It's life-changing. Okay? Encourage your Bible studies to devote themselves to prayer, and they will see amazing things happen. This was basically kind of the breakdown that we had there. You know, 3, 5, 5, 25. You know, just as you're looking forward to your plan, kind of keep these time frames in mind. You will definitely want to sit down with the other people in your group and just kind of go over a game plan. I think there'll be 3 people who did Lectio Divina training in your small group this afternoon. So sit down with those people, say, how do you want to break this up? I would suggest for the sharing section of the prayer, only one of you share to give the other people in the group time to share. But definitely sit down with each other to plan out the session and how it's going to go. We're kind of to the end of our time, so we can't say too much more on it. You know, I'll just leave you, you know, again, with that image of St. Ignatius. It started very simply with him lying on a bed recovering and opening up the scripture. He had no idea what the future had in store for him. And by simply opening up the Bible and spending some time with God in the Word through Lectio Divina, you know, there's an image of our Blessed Mother with all the Jesuit saints throughout the ages, which would not have happened had that guy not picked up the Bible and started praying. So have fun doing that yourselves. And in a few centuries, I expect nothing less from you. Okay? Thank you all.